Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to whatever time it is in whichever part of the world you're joining us from. Welcome back, for those of you who were here earlier on as well. I hope you're able to spend some time earlier getting to know your dialogue groups and maybe possibly connecting with some people you haven't seen in a while, whether old friends or maybe you met some new IFC companions during tea time. So my name's Jonas. I'll be hosting our first webinar session today. And before we introduce today's speaker, I just thought I'll touch on briefly what this session will look like. So our speaker will be sharing their ideas with us for the first 30 minutes. And after that, we'll be taking questions and potentially have a discussion with the audience. So there's going to be two different ways in which you can ask a question. The first being just by posting a comment in the chat, and I'll see that, and then you can ask a question that way. The second way is just by raising your hand in the chat function that Cedra showed us earlier how to use. And if you raise your hand, and you can ask a question through video. So whichever one you feel more comfortable with, however you want to engage, it's completely up to you. It's one other thing, we just want to remind people that we are recording this webinar just to be distributed amongst fellow participants. So if you have any problems with that or have any questions about it, please don't hesitate to contact one of our conference organizers. You can email them at creativeleadership@coforum.org. So now it's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker. Maria Paula Romero is a Colombian changemaker and a passionate believer in the power of co-creation. And she spent time working to aid community development and building up opportunities through education. She is the founder and director of the Suuralairua Library Program, which is a socially based co-educational initiative that she founded, that she began as a means by which she could fight for rights and the dignity of the Wayuu indigenous community, which is Colombia's largest indigenous community in the La Guajira region. So the program sought to transform communities and their prospects while also respecting heritage and seeking to lift them above the structural exclusion and the barriers that they faced. So today she'll be exploring a little bit of that with us and talking about how to create a space for change. So sharing ideas about how we as change makers can impact our communities, our society, and hopefully ourselves. So without further ado, I'll hand it over to Maria, who will be speaking. Thank you.
Well, hi everyone. I'm so honored to be with you. So welcome to this creative leadership module. I'm so honored. Today I will talk about a topic that I'm really passionate about it. So one that we can break paradigms with. For a long time we have heard many different ideas of what is the meaning of leadership. So let's start. Today we are going to talk about creative leadership. So one of the main topics that I'm going to talk about it is the first, be creative, customize an impact leadership model, focus on your project. The second is create spaces that transform community, build bridges that opportunity for change, and the power to co-create, giving voice to indigenous communities in Colombia. Well, for a long time, we have heard different meaning of leadership, and we have also learned during the development of our lives through people and professionals, many different meanings about leadership. For me personally, leadership is the set of skills, innate learned qualities to act towards something. And we might think that leadership is a very structured model that if we don't follow correctly, we can set an example in anything, but that's a lie. The leadership has a really interesting part and a creative part that I'm going to introduce with this image. You will ask, okay, what is the creative part of leadership if it is not a structured model? As I said in the definition, we can see how each person has their own properties, and it's here we can see leadership. I'm going to show you an example. Here we see like four different profiles of leadership. We can see, for example, the first, a person with coercive leadership. This kind of leader seeks to accomplish goal in every clear time. We can see the second profile of leadership, a person with affiliative leadership. This kind of leaders wants to build trusting bonds with their collaborators to achieve some alliance. There is another type of leadership, for example, a person with a participatory leadership, and this kind of leadership seeks to involve their collaborators in decisions. And there's another type of leadership, a person with empowering leadership. This kind of leader seeks to make his their collaborators constantly grow through learning. But imagine for a second, what about a leader who only cares about achieving goals and neglects whether his or his collaborators are being involved in the learning process? For example, we see this person that has their own qualities, but imagine for a second that we influence and transmit the knowledge. And what if we learn from what we like? Because sometimes I think that we maybe know that, oh, I know everything. No, the very creative part of leadership is that we can co-create. That is the collaborative exercise. When we have two types of different leadership, we can connect, how you see in this image, we can connect very different types of leadership, connecting ideas and different projects, and we can create another color. For example, in this image, you can see this kind of leadership and another kind of leadership, and what if we can connect this, we can create some new color, and this new color is the new leadership. That is the creative part of leadership. And I think that one of the most important things is not only put the leadership in theory. If you want to apply it, it's an idea or to a model of business, that's the important thing of leadership, that you can apply it. Why I'm going to talk about to you of a customized leadership model? Because we can build an impact formula with an added value towards the segment you want to target. As I talked to you in the slide before, I talk about this, it's important that we can co-create, because when we co-create, we can create more ideas, more impact projects. And for me, there are three important pillars to create our formula to customize our leadership model. First is motivation, because motivation, this is the engine to transmit to others the ideals and be able to do a collaborative work. The second is discovering opportunities. We have to break paradigms, however difficult it may seem along the way. We have to break that and continue discovering opportunities, because we can build a really great impact. And the third is the add value. We have to create something that makes us difference of our entry. Okay, to continue, I want to tell you a story or anecdote. I have always been passionate about volunteering and being involved in many projects. And one of my main goals in this is that I can practice and to be part of generate some change. But in the voluntary work, I had something very curious that I never came back to many places that I know, and I arrived to communities and different countries. And I was like, I want to see if the seed I put is something, I'm doing something with this, with the knowledge that I teach or the things that I learned. So coincidentally, I traveled 3 years ago in these volunteering trips, and I met a really, really nice community in my country called Wayuu, that is an indigenous community. And I did a really special click with them, and I was like, okay, I have been doing many trips and everything. What I can do something to be impacted? Because I think one of the most important things of leadership is that you can act. you can have a really great idea, but if you don't involve and don't be and you don't apply that idea in some context, it's like, I don't know, it's like put some idea or something that you have great and you don't act pretty. So after that, it was very curiously that after the trip that I know this indigenous community, I traveled to Caux, but it's an incredible program that teach me to build bridges of opportunity. You have to share your knowledge, you have to be an active in your community. So I did this trip to La Guajira and then I participated in an incredible programming call. And after this, I came back to my country and I say, I really need to implement everything. I learned many things, incredible things. I met many people that impact their communities. I want to do something. So I think that one of the most essential things is that when you want to create a project based on your leadership, it's so important that we had a co-creation process, because the leadership, other amazing thing that the leadership has is that you have to co-create in team. You can't do the things or your project by your own. You have to share it with a team, with some collaborators, with some partners and support. I'm going to give you an example that I'm going to tell you how I create a really great project with my team. But before this, we have to plan. And I want to show you like an example that we did. Before we start a project, it's so important, as I said you in the slide, we have to customize a leadership model. Why? Because every community is so special and have their own needs. That's why we have to customize a leadership model. As I'm going to show you in this example, we created a model called Guajira. Guajira is also the place where is located our project. We call Guajira Wayuu. Guajira is a leadership model that brings the essential qualities that we want to work on. So I'm going to start with the gene of genuine. Genuine, why? Because when we are going to create a project, we have to talk about real things. We don't have to talk about fictitious things that cannot be achieved in a short, a medium, or a long-term timeline. We have to make it real. Why you? Useful. For an example, we can put solar panels in caves. Simply won't work. We have to be a practical a purpose. Our purpose should be practical and applicable. To autogestion, to be that the project work in a self-management, because one of the leadership that it, for me is like one of the most important is that we must share our knowledge to create more leaders. That at the time we're not someone else, for example, I'm not be available to continue the project, or my team or other person, we have to teach them how they can self-management the project to the collaborators of a project. Why juvenile? And this is not a synonym like, oh, I have to be a young person or a teenager. No, it's a synonym of a create and to do the things with so much energy, doing the things with passion. What in? Of ingenious. Many times we think that we have to have the best technologies, the best people to work, and if we have it, it's perfect. But if we don't have it, we have to be creative and to search about what resources we have in our entering. Respectful, and I'm going to divide this in three sessions. In 3 points, the respectful. We have in every project and in every aspect in life that we are going to have a leadership, we have to have an active listening. Why? Because when we receive good or bad reviews and we appreciate it, everything constructs to us. And that has a really huge value because each member of our project is a really, really great asset. Okay, back into the word acrostic, A of adaptable, because I think that we, when we create some bridges of opportunity, the project has to be adaptable, an ability to change. And why? Because, for example, some other community in your project or in your model business wants to improve what are you doing, you have to share this and the ability to change with the project. For example, if you want to construct the same project in another community, it has to be adaptable. Okay, this sounds so good, like in the theory, and you will ask, okay, Maria, that sounds so great. What are you talking about us? And it sounds a little interesting if we can customize a model of leadership in our communities, and sounds very good in theory, but why in the application? So let's construct and let's build. So now I'm going to tell you what it's about, the project that I'm talking about before it. And one, this project is called a Biblioteca Suuralairua, or in English, Suuralairua Library. And it's located, I'm going to show you the map. It's located in Colombia, in the north part in Uribia. And 3 years ago, I traveled to Uribia, that is a department in my country. And I'm going to show like more how is this space. This place is totally deserted. It lacks vegetation. Therefore, there is a lot of lack of food, water, access to mobility, and it's very deserted. And for example, the vegetation is very dry, so that's why it's very lack of water and many essential things. But in this community, in the center of this community, there is a really incredible community called Indigenous Community Wayuu that is full of love. I'm going to share you more about this community. This community, it's their cultural identity, it's constructed by ancestral grandmothers and grandfathers. Their economy is based on grazing, cultivation, and they have a native language, and their mother tongue is Wayuu. They also speak a little bit of Spanish, but their native language is Wayuu. But it's a really community full of love. But unfortunately, they have faced very strong social and economic problems. When I traveled to this community, I was, oh my God, this community, it's incredible. And even if it was in my own country, I didn't know too much about them. But when I learned about every potential that the kids and the teenagers and the old people has, it was for me, why they're not doing like something to grow in their community, respecting their roots, because it's so important when we act in the leadership that we have to respect in a community, in whatever, where we are in every space, we have to respect where the community are. So I'm going to talk about 3 points, like even if there is a really great community, sadly, there are some points that, for example, the children in this community, more of the 70%, they are at illiteracy. Why? And you will ask, okay, but why they don't are studying or something? Because it's a really, really deserted zone. The children have to walk 3 hours or more to arrive to an educational point. They have to take very, very, very long runs that cannot be made by many children because they endure a hunger for 1 week, really, believe me. They don't take food for 1 week or more because there's a really poor zone, because the, I don't know, for the zone, and I think that maybe for all the, like we, many communities have involved in many, there are other communities that are growing more than them, and the zone, it's a little difficulty in educational program. They have many problems in social and many things, but we can center it like in the problem, what are they passing about it. So if We center in the problem, we will not doing nothing in the future. And when I arrived to my country after the Caux program, I was like, we have to do something for this amazing community and to respect their roots and their values. So, Biblioteca Suuralairua, that means roots in the dialogue, Wayuu, that is the mother tongue of them, was born, as the name says, to give fruit to another communities. It's an empirical education project led by women leaders who strive to enhance education while preserving their mother tongue, because this is so important. They are losing with the period of time their mother tongue. And I think that one of the great things that we have in Colombia, it's our indigenous community that have an amazing cultural and identity. So we create this program to give voice to this indigenous community. And you will ask, okay, Maria, what the team do to this, to construct opportunities, to construct deals, bridges. And we created Biblioteca Suuralairua. And I'm going to explain like more about what I'm talking about later in our model of leadership that is called Guajira. And we created with this acrostic, and I'm going to implement in the application. This is our place. We construct by zero in this place where nothing, and we construct with the community. Why our project is genuine? We build a library in the desert where no one can arrive like in a car, because it's very remote place. But we build it for more than 100 children that for like to have a place that will be more near to this community. Because as I said before, the children have to walk 3 hours or more, 4 or 5 hours to arrive to educational point. So we create a real project and we construct by zero. Why useful? And I'm going to tell you, as I talk to you, more of the 70% of these children are illiteracy. So we create a space that they can learn, like in a auto-learning with some women leaders in the community that are teachers. So they create this space that was constructed this year. Autogestion, why autogestion? Because the project is led by a really amazing woman leaders, as you can see in this photo. They connect through programs of educations, and there are more than 20 women that are leading this project in the self-management. Because if we are, for example, I'm living now in Bogota, that is the capital of my country, Colombia, we can't travel like each week or each month. So that's why we transmit the knowledge, what we want in the ideals that we can connect with them. So they are leading the project, and all our women, and there are some men that I'm including in this project in a really great way. Why juvenile? And as I said before, it's not meaning of young people. For example, here's my grandmother that has 80 years, but she's collaborating. And why juvenile? Because every people that you see makes all the thing with too much energy. Why we have to create a project that has to be ingenious and respectful? Because for example, as you see in the photos, it's a really deserted place. When we created, we were like, oh my God, how we are going to construct a library in the middle of the desert? But we were innovative. We created a really great team, and we collaborated with other person, and we were resourceful. We're like, okay, what resources we have in our intern. So we built a really great community of people. Quite respectful, because there's an indigenous community. And before we start to do this, we talk with the community and talk with us, what do you want? Why you want to improve in your community? Why we want to the classes, for example, will teach in their own language native, it's the Wayuu, because we want that they grow up like community, like in the future, in 3 years, we know about them, and if people come to them, they will be really impressed about their progress, but preserving their main roots. And adaptable, because sadly, there are many indigenous in community in Colombia that has the lack of education, and we want to adapt this program to other cities that we want to connect. And you will say, okay, Maria, the children were illiteracy. This space makes something, and I want to do a little emphasis in this, is that a little space or a huge space can create these opportunities for many communities. When you customize a model of leadership, you can do a great impact for others. And don't keep your knowledge, please transmit it, because when you transmit it and when you connect a really a great team or people that can facilitate, have many different qualities, you can do a really great change. For example, I want to show you this image before, is that for me, it's the meaning of leadership, to co-creation. You may be thinking, okay, they are children, they can connect, or they are, can innovate something. And let me tell you that these children has a really amazing leadership, because they're in their own community. They are, well, let's do this and let's connect this, let's learn. And even many children didn't know to write or to read. Now, 2 years ago, we are seeing these people growing in a really great mood. So that's why I create that, a little space or a huge space that can create opportunities. And there's photo, it's so emotional. Why? Because after 2 years of great work of my team and the indigenous community, the children that didn't know how to write, didn't know how to read, the same kids in the program who had a little or no education, they managed to create their first edition of stories in their mother tongue. As you can see, there are some little stories, and the children create their own stories that you can, I'm going to share it, like the link of our website, where you can learn more about their stories, but they created. So I think that we can make a really great change, starting with some little actions. And this is our community that when we adapt our model of leadership, Guajira, and if you, the people that are in other countries or the people that are in this reunion, I want to invite you that you create that space, construct bridges to your communities. Even if you don't have the resources, talk with your friends, with your family, and connect, because one of the greatest part of the leadership is this, to connect people, to construct community through bridges of knowledge. And I'm going to show you a little video. It's 2 minutes. We have time now, Jonas. I want to show you a video that resumes what we create, to encourage to you that you are seeing in the screen to create that space, that maybe you have a great idea and you say, okay, I have motivate. And I want going to, let me put again the image that I show you like in a moment before it, this image. The important part of the creative leadership is that we construct this thread that has many different types and profiles of leadership, but we have to do an exercise of co-creation. Okay, so that's like the resume of our project. And with this, I want to invite to you, to each person that is in the presentation, that construct your own model of leadership. As I talk to you, like we construct our a model called Guajira that reúne all the qualities that we want to transform this community. I want that you construct your own leadership model, that if you, for example, has another model of business or some idea, you construct your own pillars. For our project was genuine, useful, autogestion, juvenile, ingenious, respectful, and adaptable. So thank you so much, and create that space that make change and that construct opportunities. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Maria. Please let everyone join me in thanking Maria for sharing her story with us.
Thank you, Jonas.
Very much appreciated. So now we're going to move on to the moderated section of the webinar. So if you feel free to ask any questions, as we mentioned earlier, if you have any questions or anything you'd like to discuss, you have two ways of doing it. You can either share a question in the chat, or alternatively, you can share it via video. So to do this, just raise your hand by clicking on the icon labeled participants, which should be at the bottom of your screen, and put the mouse over your name and raise your hand, and then I'll spot you, and then I'll ask you to make your point, and feel free to introduce yourself and maybe a little bit about what you do before you ask a question. So they're the two ways to ask a question. So if anyone has a question they'd like to ask, please by all means share. Yep, I see one question from Sylvia. If you'd like to ask your question first.
Yeah, okay, hi.
Hi.
So, my name is Sylvia, and I am from Egypt. I live in Cairo. And my question is about how did you start finding a fund for the project? So was it a self-funding project, or you managed to ask an organization to fund you or help you with the project?
Celia, in this project, it was like, as I told in the presentation, a collaborative work. I talked with my family, my friends, and we create like a crowdfunding, many projects to recollect the funds. Also with people that it's not in our country, that we send it like some presentations and tell them how will be the impact in the future in the project. And it was a really nice thing, because when you don't have like something tangible to show the people, it's but there is going to function or not, but we receive the donation through the people. That's the answer, through the people, and connecting other programs and presenting this project to other organizations. But we receive a help of many people around the world and in our country.
Great, thank you.
So we take another question from Mustafa.
Thank you, Garcia, Maris. I must say you've done good. I'm Mustafa from Nigeria. I'm based in Lagos. Yeah, I just want to know, because I know that in most indigenous communities, it's always very difficult to penetrate and convince them of the good of your work. How were you able to, get the buy-in of the community leaders and the people as to the good you wanted to do for them? Were there any obstacles? How were you able to maneuver and collaborate with them?
Thank you, Mustafa, for that question. It's so important. Before we start this project, as I told you, I traveled to this indigenous community like for 1 month, and I were really close to the leaders, but you have to have a really important permission. In this indigenous community, there is a person called in Spanish palabrero. Palabrero is like the most important leader in this community. We talk, we sit, and we talk with him, and we tell him like, we want not to, we are of the capital, and we want to give you education. No, that's why not the, like, the main objective. We tell him like, we want to improve your community, that sadly always in almost in our country it's forgotten. We want to improve your roots through the educational program, and if you want that children involved in this, that will be amazing, because we can keep the like create a collaborative team of women leaders that teach them in their own language, because the meaning of the Suuralairua, it's roots. We want that they give fruit in their own community. And the amazing thing is that through education, we can share it to another communities. What is the importance of the community of the Wayuu? So the Palabrero, that is the Maxim leader, he gave us the permission, and he have been creating with us in this project. It was very hard because there are very, when we had the first meeting with them, they were, okay, but you are going to put like a school and why? And when we talk also with the children, because they're like, they are like the mother of this project, we they talk to us like, we want to improve in our own language, but participating in the educational programs that we can access, because we have to work 3 hours or we have many lacks of in our environment. So it was a, I think that was a really incredible goal to have the permission of the Palabrero. But the Palabrero know that we want to improve their own culture by the education.
Fantastic. So we have another question from Najla, who says, who asked, what are the challenges you faced before starting the project?
Oh, many. I can say like 1,000 of problems. One of the main was like the zone, it's a very desert zone, so you can arrive so easily. So when we have the idea, I was a little confused about what we are going to construct it, because the materials, for example, in the zone, there is no water, and the communication with other parts, it's so complicated. But I think that it was so important to have many, many profiles of leadership in my team, because, for example, in this meeting, it's a Jefferson and some other person of the project that lead, and they contribute to research that tools that we can create. So there are many possibilities, but we confronted with the team, like, okay, you are going to research for a crowdfunding, you are going to research how we can get the materials, and we also involve in this all the community, because there's a special thing that they had their own constructions. You can build, for example, with our traditional construction. No, you have to respect that segment and the environment. So it was hard, but we get it. We get it.
Correct. So I've got two more, a couple of questions that can kind of be combined. So Nick wanted to know, what was the inspiration, what inspired you to get involved in this project? And that kind of ties in with Maori's question, which was, what was kind of the driving force for you to initiate this project?
Okay, what makes me to involve in this? I think that, as I told in the presentation, I was really very passionate about the volunteering, but I never came back to that place that I was visiting. So when I met this community, I don't know, it sounds crazy, but I did a really nice click. Also because I have a terrible problem of health in the community, and they run to help me through the traditional drinks. So that for me was like, okay, they don't know me, but they are doing all the possibility to be comfortable in this place. So when I did these clicks, when later than I arrived to Caux, I think that Caux for me was like a motor to do this, because it was funny and so crazy that I traveled to La Guajira in the month of June in 2016. And after this month, I traveled to Switzerland to do this incredible program that permit me to have like a more huge vision of the problems and how you can impact through very little actions. That for me was like a call for me, I can say it, was like, hey, wake up and do something in your community with all the knowledge, because I say before, the leadership permits us to influence. And if we have knowledge and we don't improve it in something or in some idea, that will be dysfunctional for me.
So I've got another question from Noah, who asked, how do you keep the sustainability of the project? So how do you keep the project going, I think?
Okay, we have some gut parents, and as I said, the project is self-management by a woman's leader. So we are doing here in my country, in Bogotá, that is a capital, we have a nice team that is always supporting them, and also the women leaders are doing some other stuff, and we have got parents that support to this project, like monthly supporting our children for their education, books, and everything. And we also connect our government in some aspects. And there's another plus of this project, that when you create a project, you can create more spaces, for example, to work. We create our three professors that are leading the project. The government paid to them, so we create another space of work. For example, as I told you, in this community, there are many lack of an economic and social problems. So that's another bridge to co-create and to give like another opportunity to these women. So that's where we support the project.
Fantastic. So now we're going to go to a question from Angelica, who's got her hand.
Hello, everybody. Hello, Maria.
Hi.
I want to say that your project is amazing, is wonderful. I'm from Colombia too.
Oh, great.
And my question is, what do you recommend us when entering a community to break the ice? Because, for example, in my organization, we tried once to implement a project, but we couldn't connect with them.
Okay.
So what do you recommend it to us?
Okay, Angelica, thank you so much. I think that one of the most important things is that you be able like to share with them some space. For example, in my case and in the case of my team, we were connected like with them through a month, talking with them, connecting ideas and everything. And the most important thing in a project is to show to respect for their roots. For example, you know that the indigenous community has their own roots. And for example, for the Palabrero, that is the main leader, was so important that we show our respect for the community. And you have to show like the main objectives that you want the project.